Good morning, everyone. I'm Michelle DiMarzo, the Museum's Curator of Education and Academic Engagement, and welcome to our very last Art in Focus event of fall 2020. Those of you who have participated in one of our in-person Art in Focus events or have watched our other virtual conversations may know how this works. We choose one art object to have a sustained conversation about. Obviously, our in-person conversations take a little bit of a different form than they do in the virtual space. So as we go through, if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to drop them into the chat box, and then I'll address them as best I can at the end of our time together. So if you watched our most recent Art in Focus, we were talking about it's the second most recent Art in Focus. We talked about the Buddhist stele that is located in the back gallery of the Bellarmine Hall Galleries. It's actually just off to the right in this picture. You can see its base sort of at the bottom right of this photograph. I mentioned then that we're kind of taking advantage of these sessions now being virtual to focus our attention on objects that would be a little bit of a challenge to do in an in-person Art in Focus. And what I mean by that is if you've been to the Bellarmine Hall Galleries, you know the space in the back is a little bit cramped. So just as we would have had a little bit of a challenge to focus on that stele together, that Chinese stele, it would also have been a little bit of a challenge to fit 15 or so people around the case with our objects on loan from the Yale University Art Gallery. And the middle there, you can see on the right, that's the vase that we're going to be looking at today to give you a little bit of a sense of scale. And here it is in its nice professional headshot, courtesy of the Yale University Art Gallery, to whom we are very grateful for placing these objects on loan to us. And I was realizing in preparing this Art in Focus that I didn't feel like I knew this vase very well. And in part, that's because the objects in that case are relatively new arrivals to our museum. They arrived in March just as all of the shutdowns were happening. So just as our world was getting overturned, these beautiful new group of objects were arriving and installed from Yale University Art Gallery. So because of how things have been in the months since, I haven't spent as much time in the museum galleries as I normally would. So no surprise that I don't feel like I know this particular vase as well as some of the other pieces which are more long-term residents. So in that sense, it's a true pleasure to be able to sort of, you know, engage in a sustained period of looking and studying at a single art object. And that, of course, is one of the things we love doing together in Art in Focus. So here is a view of the vase with its caption, its label next to it. And a very common way to hear a vase like this referred to would be with the word attic in front of it. So you might hear someone say, oh yes, this is an attic vase from the 5th century by the group of Polygnotos. It's a red figure Calyx Krater, which would be a very good opportunity to use the phrase, it's all Greek to me, if you weren't familiar with all of those words. If you were more familiar with them, you would realize that every word in that is a very precise kind of descriptor. So for example, attic refers to Attica, the region that encompasses Athens and Greece, which is from where this object originated. We'll talk a little bit more about the other terms that are in that label, but I realize I skipped over in one sense the most important part of Art in Focus, and that is to just take a moment to look at our art object and to move around it in a way that we couldn't do if we were actually physically in the Bellarmine Hall Galleries. So you've seen it in situ, in its case. This is the view that is facing outward, but thanks to the wonder of the internet, I can also show you the sides of the vase so that you can see its low handles on each side of that, the foot at the base. And we can also see the single figure that adorns the back side of the vase. So it's not, I would say, a busy object, right? It has a very sort of economical, simple level of decoration. We have a running band of foliage around the top rim of the vase. We have another band of geometric decoration on the lower part of the vase between the handles. And then we have one figure on the front and the two figures, I'm sorry, one figure on the back and the two figures on the front. Really nothing else given to us. Now I'll focus in on the decorative scene on the front there. So I said that this is kind of object that if you saw that giant chunk of caption, there might be a lot of words in there that would be unfamiliar. Attic isn't actually in our label, but it's something that is used commonly to refer to these vases. So as I mentioned, that's describing the geographic region around Athens from which objects like this came. Polygnotos was one of the most famous vase painters. So we're talking, we've got a celebrity name attached, except it's a group of Polygnotos. So not the man himself, but a painter who worked in his orbit, created the decoration that we're seeing on this vase. And we call it a red figure. I think everyone can probably figure out why we call it a red figure vase, because the figures themselves are in red, the reddish clay of the underlying pottery itself. And then the term Calyx Krater. A wonderful thing about Greek vases is they're always given these descriptive terms that refer to their form and also to their function. So a crater, you might be able to see at the top there that this has a very broad rim. And this was a type of vase that was used at a symposium for the mixing of water and wine. So you wouldn't want something with a very narrow rim. You'd want something nice and open. And the prefix calyx refers to where the handles are located. These are low handles placed on the crater. So those two words together just give us a sense of, if you're familiar with Greek vases and you aren't even looking at a Greek vase, someone says Calyx Krater. You know, of course, I know exactly what that is, as opposed to a bell crater, for example. And finally, we have the title of what we are seeing on this Calyx Krater, Eos and Tithonos. And one of the things that was most interesting to me to learn from a conversation with Dr. Catherine Schwab, who is faculty member at Fairfield University, and also responsible in a large way for these objects being present in our galleries. She was telling me about how vases like this were used in ancient Greece. And I knew they would be used in a symposium. You would place them on a pedestal, that you would mix water and wine inside them. But I asked her about, she referred to the backside with the male figure. And I said, oh, so there's always one side that is facing out. And she said, of course, there's one side that we are intended to focus most of our attention on. We, the guests at this symposium. And of course, we'd all have to rack our memories now and remember what parties were like. But that's what this is for, a dinner party in ancient Greece. And there's one side of this vase that we all look at and admire, even at the same time as it's functional for the mixing of water and wine. And if you're wondering why they did that, they diluted the wine. It was too strong to drink in its undiluted form. You can imagine it also helps keep the party rolling longer. But that was very interesting to me to know that even though this is a fully three-dimensional object around which we can move, the painter is thinking about the scene that we will be focusing most of our attention on. And in this case, it is a mythological scene. So we're looking at a myth that is not probably one of the best known, but it was one that was very, and I would say best known today, very commonly depicted on Attic vases. The myth is Eos and Tithonos. Eos was the goddess of the dawn, and Tithonos was a beautiful Trojan prince that the goddess fell in love with. So if you know anything about Greek mythology, you would know that there's a lot of this going on, right? People who are immortal and divine falling in love with those who are not. And very often these stories don't have a terribly happy ending. In the case of Eos, she decided to ask Zeus for immortality for her young lover, and Zeus granted it, but she forgot to ask for his immortal youth as well as immortality. So he was immortal, but would continue to age and decay. So it's kind of a tragic tale there. We're not seeing the end of the story on this particular vase. Rather, we are seeing the moment of pursuit. So on the left, we are seeing the goddess Eos. We see she has these beautiful wings spread out behind her, and she is pursuing the young prince who is turning back to look at her as he moves away. And what's really wonderful here, even though I describe this as sort of an economical vase, and I don't mean that in the sense of it's cheap financially, but rather the painter has not needed to do a great deal to present us with a very convincing representation of two figures in motion. So if you just look at the way that the drapery, the lines constructing the drapery are drawn to give us, especially around her feet, this wonderful swirling pattern showing us that she's wearing a robe that is moving. So it's not just that their heels are lifted off the ground, the fact that Tithonos is sort of leaning away in a sort of classic pursuit. She's reaching forward toward him, but it's also just the way their garments are drawn to give us a sense that there is really a movement happening here as we would move around the vase. You also might notice in looking at Eos that she has her hair bound up in some sort of fabric covering. She's wearing what would appear to be an earring in one ear. And then over on the other side, Tithonos, he has his robe draped with one shoulder bare. We can see the wonderful little ringlets in his hair, which I think is really lovely. And we don't get a sense from the scene given to us of how the story is going to end. And this is a very common genre on Greek vases like this to show scenes of pursuit. Usually, and most commonly, it would be male figures, male gods, Apollo pursuing Daphne, that sort of thing. Eos is sort of a rare example of the female goddess pursuing the young male prince. And as I said, it doesn't have a terribly happy ending, but we can ignore that for the purposes of the vase and just admire the scene that is given to us on it. Oh, I also wanted to mention, this is something that, again, comes from Dr. Catherine Schwab, who, along with Dr. Maurice Rose, has been using these objects loaned to us by the Yale University Art Gallery for their classes, both in virtual and in in-person form. So Kathy was able to share with me some of the common responses that students have to looking at this vase. And it's sort of helpful to fill in what would be in an in-person gathering our sort of natural conversation, the things we notice as we are looking together at this object. She said that one of the most common things that students ask her is why Eos is winged. Or rather, they ask her, or they assume, perhaps at first glance, that, oh, well, that must be an angel figure. And she explained how she sort of walks them through the logic of, okay, so we are in 5th century ancient Greece. We are well before the dawn of Christianity. Would this really be an angel in the Christian sense? And of course, the answer is no. If you're familiar with other depictions in ancient art, ancient Greek art, you know that winged figures do appear. And typically the winged figures are those that are messengers of some kind, or they are ones who can move between the realms of the mortal and the divine. So the wings are an important signifier of that this isn't just some mortal woman pursuing a mortal man, but rather that this is a goddess. This is the goddess of the dawn pursuing Tithonos, unfortunately, to his ultimate detriment, let's say. So if we're thinking about the medium of this vase, going back to that very long, I'll go back to the very long caption here. Group of Polygnotos, red figure, Calyx Krater with Eos and Tithonos. Well, going backwards, we've just talked about the pursuit scene of Eos and Tithonos. We can see now that its dates between 440 to 425 BCE. So if you're wondering where this places us, if you want something to sort of tie it to historically, think of at this moment in Athens, some of the greatest construction works are being done atop the Acropolis on the Parthenon. So we are really in sort of the prime of classical Greece. And vase painting had been one of the most prominent forms of artistic production in Greece since around the year 600 BCE. So flash forward to the 5th century, this is something that is a very well-developed form of artistic production. And in fact, by this time, is one of Greece's 3 top exports. The others are silver and, of course, olives. And we would not be surprising to know that one of the greatest import markets for these Greek Attic painted vases is Italy, specifically the Etruscan civilization in Italy, loved their Greek vases. So production is high. Somewhere around 100,000 ancient Greek vases survive, almost all of them in fragmentary condition, of course. And this one is a red figure vase. I said before that it might be self-explanatory why we would call it red figure. If you've ever encountered Attic Greek vases, you know that there are really only 2 options. You have black figure vases and you have red figure vases. The black figure was the earlier form, the earlier style of creating these vases, and then it was replaced by red figure. But all it means is that there are really a very limited number of colors that an ancient artist had to work with. And I should mention that although the name that we give at the beginning of the caption for this object, group of polygnotos, refers to the painter, refers to the artist who created the design, so in some ways, the real authority in ancient Greece was the potter, the person who actually cast this on the wheel, often in segments. So usually with a Greek vase, the handles, for example, would have been created separately and then attached to the body of the vase. But it's the potter's workshop. It was really where all of the action happened, and the potter contracted the painter to do the decorating. Unfortunately, the potter's name in this instance does not survive to us, so we focus on this unknown person in the group of polygnotos. But these painters really had two options. You had the red, that is the natural appearance of the clay when it's been fired, and then you have black. And the black is achieved by denying oxygen to the surface of the vase during the firing process. And they can do that by applying something we call slip, S-L-I-P, which is really just sort of a liquid form of clay. So in the earliest forms of vase painting, they were creating the figures against a red background by using this black slip. If you reverse that, if you think in sort of a negative fashion, if you cover everything except the forms that you want to show up in red in black slip, the result after firing will be something like this. And as I mentioned, the black figure was the earlier form. By this time, red figure painting is really where it's at. You can go to either the Yale University Art Gallery or the Metropolitan, and you'll see many examples of both styles of vase painting. But you'll notice as time goes on, it is the red figure vase painting that sort of takes ultimate precedence. Sorry, I'm taking a moment to admire the geometric patterning underneath their feet, which we weren't seeing. We were seeing so that sort of zoomed in, close cropped view of this. And I see we have one question in the chat, so I'm just going to check that for a second. Something they'll hold their question. The other thing that I find very interesting about this particular example of a red figure Attic vase comes from its provenance. And you'll see in the credit line, it says lent by the Yale University Art Gallery. It gives who is the gift, of Mrs. William H. Moore. But if we go forward a little bit, going back around our vase, and we didn't talk about this guy, which is a shame. He's just a simple figure. He's not apparently related to the pursuit scene on the other side. And going back to what I had said earlier, that I was surprised to learn that Greek vases always had sort of a focal scene to which we are intended to give more of our attention. And in this case, it is Eos and Tithonos. It is not this male figure who has his hand out very elegantly and who also has this wonderfully drawn drapery that gives this impression of forward movement. So we give our apologies to him that he's the backside of the vase, where Eos and Tithonos are the stars. Here we go. So this I copied directly from the Yale University Art Gallery's website for this image showing the provenance of this particular vase. And perhaps you might have seen as I was going through the photographs that show all the way around the vase as a three-dimensional object, there are very clear lines where the object was broken and repaired. In fact, I'll just go here back where we see closely. For example, if you look down to the bottom right where the right handle is connected, we can see an obvious break. You can also see a line of breakage and repair at the upper right around the rim. And of course, if we think about these objects as objects that have lived, an object that has lived since the 5th century, but in material terms is a clay pot. I mean, it's extraordinary that 100,000 of these have survived to us, but it should be no surprise that when they were uncovered, they were usually uncovered in pieces and had to be put back together. And this one is in extraordinarily good condition, but it's always good to be reminded of that nothing really comes to us from the ancient world in 100% perfect condition. It would be, you know, a miracle for it to do so. And it's also no surprise, perhaps, based on what I had said before about who was buying these beautifully decorated Attic Greek vases. The big export market was Italy. So this particular vase was not uncovered by an excavation in Greece, but rather by someone digging in Italy, in Nola. As you see there, it was dug up by Signor Doria of Santa Maria di Capua, and acquired then through his family. So we're looking at the 19th century. So unknown when this vase gets buried or what its circumstances had been, but it gets reborn into the world into the 19th century. And what's extraordinary, in my view, is its history after that. So it's dug up in Italy, and somehow it winds up being a prize offered to artists at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, PAFA. I asked Dr. Schwab if this was something that was common. She said she had sort of heard of it, but really didn't know much more about it. But I invite us all to imagine you are an art academy student and you've created some great sculpture, you've done some great painting, and you win the medal for that year. But instead of a medal, they hand you an Attic Greek vase as your prize. I mean, I would sign up for that art school in a heartbeat. We should think about this in the studio art program here at Fairfield. I joke, Dr. Schwab would never permit it. So it's interesting to imagine the unknown biography of all art objects, but especially ones where we have these interesting little bits of trivia. We know it was made in Greece. It traveled to Italy, dug up there by an Italian nobleman of some kind, passes to the United States, is used as a prize to be won, and then ultimately is donated to the Yale University Art Gallery, who has, as I mentioned, generously placed it on loan to Fairfield University Art Museum. And I had also asked Dr. Schwab in our conversation, I'm going to go back to the first slide I showed you. I mentioned almost all of the objects in this case are ones that came to us on loan in March from Yale. And I asked her, you know, she and Dr. Maurice Rose went to Yale to meet with the curators to see what they might be able to borrow for Fairfield. And I asked her how she made her selections, you know, why this crater, why these vases? And she pointed out that from her perspective, she's always looking for objects that really work well in a teaching context. Because of course, we are an academic art museum, we're a teaching museum. We hope that, you know, all of the objects that we have on view have a real sort of resonance and connection for our students. So she said that she was drawn to its wonderful condition and the way that she knew that she could use it as a teaching object in her classes. So I look forward to getting to know this vase a little bit better during its time with us. And I want to mention again that I am indebted to Dr. Schwab for talking to me about with her great wealth of knowledge about Attic vase painting. And if anyone has any questions or any responses that they would like to share, please feel free to do so. We have a question from Kathy Carroll. And she asks, do you think there will ever be an effort to repatriate this piece? I'm always wondering why some pieces are the object of repatriation campaigns, but others are not. That is a great question, Kathy, and it's one that really gets to the heart of one of the most important conversations that's going on in nearly museums all around the world, and that is making sure that, you know, you can account ethically for how the objects in your care arrived there. And if there are questions, being prepared to be transparent and to answer them. I would say the short answer lies in the provenance that I gave you previously, which comes from the Yale University Art Gallery's website. And it really goes along with what were the laws in place when these objects were exported from their place of origin and brought to the United States. So typically the legal standard that museums follow is a UNESCO accord that was signed in 1970 about the protection of cultural heritage. So that really governs movement of objects out of their countries after 1970. Prior to 1970, things that were were on the market before 1970 are really subject to a different sort of set of ethics. And the question is, you know, was it acquired legally? Was there a bill of sale? We have acquired by Henry de Morgan from Camere de Galozzi, who had inherited it from his uncle. So there's this clear chain of who owned it, who had the right to sell it at that time, et cetera, et cetera. If we were to move this to 2020, if someone in Italy dug this vase up in their, you know, in their vineyard, they would not be able to sell it under the same conditions because those new, you know, both Italian national laws and the UNESCO convention would probably prevent it. It would probably be required to be kept in Italy as an object of national patrimony. But that's a really fantastic question. And again, it's one that I'm always encouraging students to look closely at things like provenance, at things like credit lines, and, you know, to be ready to ask those questions. How did it get here? Who paid for it? Where did the money come from? These are all great questions to ask about art objects. In this particular case, though, it will not be subject to a repatriation request from Italy. I don't see that we have any other questions in the chat, but I remind you that you're always welcome to send any questions that might pop up in your mind. You're welcome to send them to museum@fairfield.edu, and we'll do our best to answer them. And I thank you again for participating in our last Art in Focus of 2020, and we will look forward to seeing you again in spring 2021. If you're wondering what objects we'll be featuring in Art in Focus in our next series, you can go to our website, www.fairfield.edu/museum. Click on Programs, and you can see our full program calendar for the spring semester is already posted. So thank you again. I hope everyone has a wonderful end of the year, and we'll see you in 2021.